name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart, confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me and forgive my sins.
Glory to God, merciful Father.
I have the word of the sinner. Confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and trust you deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you with boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy and innocent that their sufferings may have, and for the love of the Son of Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, and the Lord's will be.
On this your confession, I by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever.
Thank you.
Grant that we may gladly hear your word proclaimed among us and follow its direction. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading for this fourth Sunday after Pentecost is from Jeremiah, the 28th chapter. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to Hananiah, the prophet, in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord make the words that you have prophesied come true, and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord, and all the exiles. You hear how this is now? Yet hear now this word that I speak to you in the hearing, and in the hearing of all the people, the prophets who preceded you, and me from ancient times, prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesied peace, when the word of that prophet comes to pass, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet." This is the word of the Lord. Oh, the depth and the riches of wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and how unchangeable his ways. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. The epistle is from Romans, the 7th chapter. "For do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person only as long as he lives. Thus, a married woman is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lived with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law. And if she married another man, she is not an adulteress. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may be bear fruit for God. For while we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit of death. But now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we not serve under the old written code, but the new life of the Spirit. What then shall we say? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, 'You shall not covet.' But sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came alive and I died. The very commandment that promised life to me proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me, and through it killed me. So the law is holy, and the commandment Did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for God.
Even without trying to damage
shoulder excursions that we've been on, not to mention the moments where you went, where in the world did I think I was going? Or I don't remember ever being in Truth or Consequences, you see that said. And as they were going along the road, someone said to Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. To another, he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Yet another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me say farewell to those of my own. And Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, they didn't have mega tractors like the Challenger 18.1 liter turbo diesel that's about half the size of our sanctuary in the first century. They had a thing called the arg, or the scratch plow, driven by a team of oxen. And it was challenging to make that go in a straight line on a good day. And the hard scrabble land there made it even worse. Plowing was hard work. And you had to set not only your back into it, but your full concentration. No one who looks back while they're trying to plow makes a straight road. No person is ever on a straight path as it could be. The average driver is not going to make it one lap in a NASCAR event. The average Christian does not have perfect knowledge. We go in fits and starts, and frequently we look back to see, am I doing it right? The one who looks back plowing plows an inconsistent field. The field under his care never becomes mature and more manageable because the attention it receives is of intermittent quality. Rather than well-plowed terrain, the map of our lives is more like the surf on the beach crashing on the shore. Sometimes it has the clockwork precision of a metronome. Other times it just roars and crashes, and others it's so still, you wonder if the water has ever moved before, and will it ever do so again? And our faith and our hunger for the Word ebbs and flows in the same way. The things of God sometimes consume so much of our attention that we maybe even go overboard, almost to the point of idolatry. And other times it cools off so much that we barely notice it's there at all. The one who plows in spirit, but not in person, like a student on the day before the last day of school, may check out altogether, leave the job unfinished. We might begin a Bible reading plan with good intentions, but after a few weeks, 2 years out. Prayer journal, things like a good idea for a few days, and then we let that go too. Now, don't get the wrong idea. Doing those things are great things, but doing them or not doing them, that doesn't make you a good or a bad Christian. The motivation behind them, the lack of something in your life that made you seek to do those things, that's more of what we're talking about. After all, you don't talk to your children 1 week out of the month or your spouse 1 week out of the month and then ignore them the other 3 weeks, do you? But Jesus is concerned with his bride every minute of every day. The one who plows and looks back allows disruption and distraction to subvert his work in the field. The plowman is unaffected, but what of the crops? How much attention will those plants get if the rows they are planted in are plowed without care? And we only need to see the result of distracted driving once for Jesus' point to be made for them. But all of this up to this point has been nothing but the law. The law, the law, the law. And that is Jesus' entire intent. Because it's not about plowing or being a good driver, a diligent student of the Bible, or a ferocious and steadfast prayer warrior. Those are all fine things, but can we do all of them all the time perfectly? Of course not. The good news is that when we don't, Jesus is there for you. Martin Luther wrote a little book called The Freedom of a Christian, and it's available online. You can read it for free. The short version is that true Christian freedom comes comes when we are slaves to the Word of God. The prophetic nature of Luther's writing is that the problems he saw in his day are the exact same problems we have today. Not because of his prescience, but because of the universality of humanity's brokenness, which he understood masterfully, because he understood it very, very personally. We have people trying to do internet communion, use grape juice instead of wine, turning the Lord's Supper into something we have to do because it's a work, instead of a gift that we receive according to Christ's institution. And that's just one of the things we have going on in the LCMS. The world at large, people are frightened. Sometimes it's legitimate. Other times it's unnecessary. But regardless, many, many people are scared right now. And unfortunately, that fear spreads faster than a virus. We have an unprecedented opportunity to spread the truth in love, the gospel comfort of faith and the forgiveness of sins. Not about our practice and our ceremonies, but letting people know that they are forgiven, that you forgive them, bearing their weaknesses, having concern for the weaker brother's conscience. And it is also a time to remain steadfast and do not compromise on those things that cannot be compromised. At times, we're going to have to swallow some pride. Sometimes, we're going to have to temper our tongues. Sometimes, we're going to have to know when listening is the thing to do rather than speaking. It's back to the basics. Nothing new, nothing rather. All those things we're already supposed to be doing in our daily walk together. But extraordinary times have a way of recentering and grounding people. Sort of like waking up after you've received a knockout punch. That's what Christian freedom is. Simple truths, simple elements connected to the all-powerful Word of God. The Word that we have been given to drive back the darkness in the world. We're being pulled in multiple directions simultaneously. Asked to pick sides, socially, politically, morally. And people, rather than starving for a lack of knowledge, are glutted with confusing and conflicting messages. Some we can't help, but one we sure can. What does a God-pleasing life look like? What do we do when we fail at it? Forgive me. Take eat, take drink. Your sins are forgiven. There are many issues. We can help with some of the answers, and we can even point out when some of the questions shouldn't even be asked in the first place. But for the most important things, we've been given all the words that we will ever need. And when it gets difficult, and it will get difficult, Jesus said, do not be anxious about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given you in that hour. And that is Christian freedom. Jesus exaggerated sometimes to make rhetorical points, often with humor, frequently with sarcasm. This time he did not. Not about letting the dead bury their own dead. Not even about one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. About the Son of Man not having any place to rest his head. For the Son of Man came to rest his head only once his work was finished. And then he laid it back upon a pillow of olive oil. When the time for his Sabbath rest was at hand, he declared, it is finished, and gave up his spirit, so that the only looking back you ever have to do is look back to the day you were baptized, the day that your sins were drowned in those waters, and your soul cleansed in the blood that flowed from his wounds. And from that fixed point in time, there is never again a need to dwell on the past, because you have been set on a course as straight as the flight of an arrow. And that course leads to eternal life and eternal peace. Yes, we go off course along the way. We trip and fall to the left and to the right, and at times, yes, we look back. We are not fit for the kingdom of God. But Jesus Christ is is and was and always will be, and his worthiness makes you worthy to be called kings and queens in his name. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace which passes understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Shine upon you to be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and healing.